Yay! I've been wanting to bring this show back for ages, but like I've just never found the right topic, so now's about as good a time as any. So, let's talk about continuity. So Vox recently put out a video as part of its Overrated series in which its host, Phil Edwards, lays out the case that the Disney-owned and branded Marvel Cinematic Universe is overrated because its continuity is detrimental to its overall quality. Using as its primary source of comparison the Tommy Westphal hypothesis, in which a surprising amount of television can be linked back through continuity to the surprise twist endings and elsewhere, as a means of demonstrating that a vast universe made up of connections to other media is inherently meaningless, and going as far as to compare the soon-to-be non-canon Fox X-Men universe as superior, because it has a pre-built universe of history and politics that the characters have to interact with, in the process managing to completely sidestep the fact that the X-Men universe has been trying to both fix and unfix its continuity since 2006, and is now essentially just limping to the finish line like a car crash victim with a chunk of glass stuck in its head. Also, while we're at it, Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2, Civil War, Black Panther and Thor Ragnarok say hi. The video in question has ended up pissing a lot of people off. It's condescending, it's badly researched, and from my perspective just shows all the signs that they wrote it really, really quickly and nobody thought to go back and do a second pass. But likely you already know this already. In fact, there's a good chance that I'm not the first person that you're hearing about it from. Captain Midnight has already posted a great rebuttal titled Why Vox's MCU Video Feels Empty, and both Ashley Lynch and Bob Chipman have already given it a good roasting on Twitter. And rather than taking this as an opportunity to simply dunk on Vox, which, alright, I suppose I kind of am, I thought now would actually be a good chance to talk about this new paradigm of movie making in the social media age. I also need to acknowledge that this essay is in part inspired by Bob Chipman's MC Utens video that he did for The Escapist. You should check it out, it's really good. So to be clear here, the annoyance isn't that someone dared to say something negative about Marvel. The problem is that the video and its implications are kind of insulting to a lot of people's intelligence. Because, like, nobody showed up to Infinity War going, oh boy, I certainly hope that they reconfirm that Ant-Man is a thing in this universe. And if you did, then on that particular front, you may have found yourself a tad disappointed. I think the fatal mistake here is in assuming that it's the continuity that drives people to see these movies, and that it's Marvel's key selling feature. That's essentially what the Vox video does. It presupposes that's the reason why they've been so successful, and ultimately why its assessment places too much value on the continuity. The crux of the video is essentially that the Marvel Cinematic Universe is bad because it's too large with too many characters and too many genres, and therefore its continuity cannot be centered on anything. Well, gee whiz, mister, it's almost as if there's something else entirely that's driving these movies. The thing about Marvel's continuity is that internally it's primarily used as a marketing exercise rather than a storytelling tool, and it's kind of annoying that in the 10 plus years that Marvel have been doing these movies, both studios and critics alike routinely fail to get this. And when it is utilised as a storytelling tool, it's usually kicked off to the side as offhand remarks or post-credit stuff. And I think what's so good about Marvel and Disney in terms of creating the MCU is that they've allowed it to happen organically and not been overt in pushing the continuity, and as such, from my perspective, it's resulted in a universe that feels as colourful and vibrant as the pages that it initially sprang from. It's weirdly paradoxical that the more laissez-faire Marvel are, the more cohesive it all feels. Like, yep, we've got ninjas and robots and Norse deities and monsters. It kind of works the same way that fan fiction works, i.e. here's Sherlock Holmes fighting Doctor Who with lightsabers and I'll think up how it fits together later. That's it. That's literally all we're talking about here. The only thing that's remarkable about Marvel's continuity is merely that it has one, and that it's lax enough to allow them to do the fun things that are actually fun. And that's the point here. The continuity helps it feel like a world, but it's not the be-all and end-all. It's secondary only to the characters, because that's the real secret here. It turns out the continuity doesn't actually matter, not when there's a decent story and compelling characters keeping the engine running. The reason why fans keep coming back to Marvel is because they've got fun, colourful characters that bounce off each other in amusing ways. And it's for that reason that they're about to make a bajillion dollars by slamming all of them together for Infinity War Part 2, or whatever it is they end up calling it. Like, one of the things that I'm most looking forward to isn't figuring out how all the history and canon fits together, or the action set pieces, or the special effects, or even the production design. The thing I'm most looking forward to is watching Steve Rogers and Tony Stark reconnect for the first time since Civil War. Because that scene in the face of Thanos' assault on planet Earth is going to be a slice of fried gold. The fun characters bouncing off each other aspect is what's important here, because that's how these characters characters become iconified after all these years, in spite of their origins as filler for low-grade pulp. They become iconic not just because of having them be around, but by having them be played with in various permutations across time. Superman was initially created as a power fantasy by two Jewish teenagers from Cleveland, Jerry Siegel and Joe Shuster, but over the years he's meant different things to different people and different writers, even if some of them are non-canon. Grant Morrison has used Superman as a way to deal with the death of his father, meanwhile Frank Miller has used him as a symbol of Reagan-era authoritarianism, and so on and so forth. No one actually thought these characters would be around for as long as they have, because they were literally just throwing ideas at the wall and seeing what stuck, with no attempt at self-importance. Because they were literally low-grade pulp designed for easy consumption by children. But they've never treated that as a bug, they've treated it as a feature. Because they're larger than life and have fun, oversized characteristics, they can take on board a surprising amount of narrative weight as mythic figures. I mean, yes, Marvel and DC did end up smashing their characters into their respective universes as a means of selling more books, but there is a reason why these characters have been around for nearly 100 years at this point. It's because they're good characters, and they're allowed to be good characters by a continuity that means that they can affect each other. And like I said earlier, the key reason why so many studios have faltered whilst Marvel has succeeded is that they repeatedly mistake Marvel's marketing practices for Marvel's storytelling practices. And this is best illustrated by the Vox video's insistence that pre-building a universe with a rigid continuity is the best way to go, even though it never works. As an absolutely perfect example of this, Batman v Superman Dawn of Justice was so full of extraneous setup for continuity-style franchise building, up to and including its own fucking name, with so many go-nowhere scenes that do nothing for the narrative beyond their mere function as obnoxious sequel baiting, that the actual Batman vs Superman story gets so little traction that it almost makes you forget about how stupid Lex Luthor's plan ultimately is to get Batman to kill Superman. I even remember thinking before I went in the theatre, who on earth decided that a Batman vs Superman story absolutely needed to be 3 hours long, and then I realised why the hard way. It's for that reason that I still kind of prefer Man of Steel, even though I know I'm not really supposed to like it because all of Warner Brothers' problems are still present in the film itself, but at least it's primarily an action movie and that LexCorp and Batman only exist as signage, but that's another conversation for another day. So my point here is that continuity should always take a backseat to characters and storytelling, and the reason why Marvel have been doing so well is that they're good movies first and part of a larger whole second. And I know we live in a media landscape in which everyone likes to play follow the leader rather than, you know, lead, so I'll say this. If the rest of Hollywood insists on copying Marvel, then the thing that's going to prove successful is copying the self-assured confidence in the material, not the business strategy. So in a long-winded sort of way, what I'm saying is that those who focus on Marvel's continuity as the source for their success are looking entirely at the wrong thing. I mean, the irony of all this is that the Tommy Westfall hypothesis, you know, that thing that Vox uses as weirdo copypasta bullshit whilst using it as its primary analogy, was originally proposed by comics legend Dwayne McDuffie as an exercise in what happens when you take continuity too seriously. See, this is why you think and do research before you sound off on things you're not that familiar with. Sass. Thank you.